Hello, Jared here again. I'm back with another video called Embracing Failure. This one's slightly uncomfortable for me to make if the Polishing Turds video wasn't enough, because this kind of exploits my own failures and my own troubles that I went through going through one of the pieces I was working on. Now, I originally planned to just have this as like a nice speed paint with music to it, but it ended up going so badly that I really couldn't justify making it a smoothly done video because I had to completely redo entire parts of this piece. And recording that didn't really work out. I ended up actually just turning off everything. I didn't want any distractions, I didn't want any recordings. And I just slaved away in private, just making sure that it was done right. Now, not to put anyone off, because I'm not here to make anyone angry or uncomfortable. This isn't about whether how badly or how well I'm drawing this. It's not about the quality of the art. That's completely subjective. What matters for me is what I was trying to achieve, which I've mentioned before. I've had this idea for this picture with these characters for a couple months now. And I even saw the vision in my head, like how I could see it, what was going on, and I knew what I was after, but as I kept going, I wasn't feeling that eureka moment. When I was looking at these characters, I'm going, I drew it. It kind of looks the way I was thinking it, but it doesn't have that, I don't know how to say it, that magic, that sparkle, or that X factor, that thing that makes the piece pop, that the thing that where you look at the characters, you believe it, and it looks like there's strong conviction behind what the characters are doing. And that was kind of a battle I started realizing I was running into. Now, one thing some people might think, and I certainly thought it, is, well, you should plan your piece out better. You should. Thumbnail, you should know what you're drawing before you draw it. Well, yeah, in some cases I do, and I knew the content and the composition of this piece long before I sat down to draw it. And I knew that, yeah, it may turn out a little bit different. It doesn't turn out exactly what you see in your head, and fortunately, a lot of times it turns out better. And in this case, ultimately in the end, there is a happy ending to this. It did turn out better than I had hoped, but it was a pretty nasty road getting there, and I went through a lot of frustrating days thinking about how I was going to pull this off. Now, I realize this is a drawing video, and when you have problems and frustrations, you can just keep saying first world problems, because yeah, there's so many more people that have worse problems than figuring out how you're going to draw a picture on your computer. So I'm not trying to bring that up. But if we are going to completely focus on this as a problem, one of the a funny quote, actually it's not funny at all. A friend of mine, he's a big history buff, and one of the quotes that he likes from Winston Churchill is, "If you're going through hell, keep going." And it's funny how I just remembered that now because that is a true statement for life, and you're never going to get out unless you keep going. So failure is a fact of life. I would say everyone has found that out at a certain point. If you lived long enough, if you can't say that you've ever failed, then you haven't grown up. Because failure happens to the best of us. I don't care who you are. I would say that you are emotionally more mature if you can admit faults and failures within yourself, because that's how you grow. And I realize that's part of the learning process. And the fact that I haven't been drawing that long, I just openly accept that it's gonna happen. And sometimes at the least suspecting places. Because I had been on a roll for a while, and I felt I was getting more comfortable in my drawing and my designs. And I was gearing up to go do a polished piece. And I'm like, I'm gonna do this. I've been planning it. I've got it all calculated. But I was also a little nervous. And once I started this, it bit me in the ass a little bit more than I thought. I was thinking, oh, I'm probably just hyping myself up. It'll be okay. But no, it really wasn't. And I realized I was falling into a bit of a rut. And I'm not really surprised because I just realize I still have so much to learn. Now, in one of my earlier videos, I discussed to try to ask yourself what you're seeking out. What are you trying to achieve? What are your goals? Doing a polished piece, for me, I had been sketching for months, doing character designs, and I realized, okay, I need to get back into the groove of trying to learn how to finish a piece. And I wanted to tackle something a little bit different, and I chose a couple of topics in my head that I wanted to focus on. And this piece in particular, I was really thinking about colors and how I was going to approach that compared to everything I've done in the past. Because when it's polished, it is going to come off a little bit different than just a sketch. And I knew that. And for a while, I didn't even think I was going to do line art. I thought I was going to just keep the pencil and keep it very kind of, I don't know, gritty looking. But as I kept keeping it that way, I realized, no, I got to keep doing the line art. Small steps, small steps. So I was going to focus mainly on colors and a little bit of perspective and the sense of space, because I wanted to do kind of a big environment. Like, you can really kind of see this world that I'm trying to show. However, I ran into problems much earlier than the coloring process. it was mainly the composition itself. And to explain what this picture, what's happening in this picture, these are two characters of mine, Arlo on the left and Lily on the right. And this is actually Lily's first finished piece I've ever drawn her in. She's only lived as a concept until now. Arlo's been drawn a couple times. His design has changed a couple of times. But I knew I really wanted to try his new look, and I knew I had to hit that from the concepts. But anyway, what's happening is Lily's character is kind of a smart and sassy and practical girl. They come from different worlds. She kind of comes from a lower class, more, I don't want to say poverty, but she's kind of comes from the refugee style camp, and Arlo is someone that's kind of grown up a little bit privileged and naive, and he doesn't realize what he has. Through circumstances, they met and known each other, and he tries to charm people. He's kind of a goofball, and she calls him out on all his fake crap because she's very real. She's more real than pretty much anyone in the cast, and he doesn't like the fact that she calls him out all the time, and she's right all the time. So what does he do? Well, he's a goofball. He can do what he can do. It's called embarrassing her in public. And that's part of his charm and part of his ridiculousness. And that's what he's doing here, is that he has no shame and has decided to just drop an E and do song and dance and completely embarrass the hell out of Lily. And after saying all that, I realized in order for this piece to be successful is that I had to sell those emotions. I had to sell those reactions, the pose, the gesture, everything. And I knew that this entire piece was going to fall on that. Not how clean it looked, not how good the background was. It was about the subject matter. And I knew that from the start. But as I kept going, it just wasn't happening the way I thought I was seeing it in my head. Like, Arlo on the left was originally going to have his eyes closed, and I was going to have his hand kind of swinging out, like kind of this whole Broadway stage. But then I realized, no, I think I still want to see his eyes. You know, I think that, you know, with these new designs, I know there's a better way I can show it. And I would draw for such, I don't know how much time I lost, but I would go to bed just, you know, with work on this, and I would not feel satisfied. I just knew something. I wasn't feeling that conviction, that eureka moment where I'm really happy with where this piece is going. And it got to the point, you know, I realized I had to completely just erase some of my work, not bandage it, not fix it up, because I tried doing that for a while. It just wasn't working out. And I realized I got to erase this whole thing, and I got to start fresh. For Arlo, I got away with it a little bit better. I had to start over on his face, and I couldn't decide what to do with his arms. But Lily for me was a disaster, and it just wasn't working out. Now, let me back up for just a second, because I realized I said time lost. And as far as the end goal, I mean, I felt like that, but when you're sitting down to draw, especially when you're trying to do a big finished piece, it's not necessarily time lost. There are so many things in art being practiced here. I mean, it's just like a huge amount of learning going on. I mean, just line art, color, shade, composition, perspective, gesture, pose, you name it. Everything is going on here. I'm working on all of that. I had certain goals in mind. But even if I have to erase and start over, guess what? That's more mileage. That means I get more experience. That means that's just one less mistake I'm going to make in the future because I learned something in that. Even if I got frustrated through it, I need to see the light in that. And sometimes it's hard to see, but you know, this isn't a class assignment. This isn't even client work. This is personal work. And I mean, what's the fear here? That I'm going to get better because I made a mistake? They're going to happen. And that's exactly what I was going through. And I realized, no, I might be frustrated now, but I know if I just truck through this, if I just keep going, I'm eventually going to hit what I want and I'm going to feel so much better. Because think about the alternative. Think about, think like, oh, I'm not going to go back and redraw this. Like, oh, I don't like this, but it's good enough. Now we're entering the polishing turd phase where you know that it probably shouldn't keep going and you get lazy. You get fearful that, well, what if I erase it and it looks even worse the next time? Well, if you drew it well one time, you can do it again. It's just going to happen. You can't do worse forever. You're gonna get better. It's that fear of putting the time in and getting back what you had. But most of the time, if you do it again, it turns out way better and you're gonna thank yourself. Because the last thing you want to do, as I said before, is when you get lazy, you hold on to that mediocre drawing or that thing that's bugging you and you spend the next 20 to 30 hours polishing it. Now it's too late. Now you've really wasted time rather than spend, you know, another hour or two getting it just right on that pencil work, which you should have done. And I knew that's what I had to do. So for the sake of time, there's huge gaps between some of the edits that I did. I mean, there was one just furiously fast-paced night where I just turned off everything and just started drawing. But I'm going to throw up a couple of the phases that I went through. And I'll just kind of show you the path that I was going down so I can just kind of cut to the chase here. So this first picture here, there were some things that I had thought of originally. Arlo's face with the eyes shut, I had thought of. I didn't know what the heck I was doing with that left arm. The right arm was originally going to be open palm, but I decided to give him a hat. I'm like, yeah, let's give him a little hat. But the left arm, I wasn't sure what was happening. I thought I could do more with it, give him more conviction. I wanted that arm out. But then I started looking at his face and went, there's still something generic about the face. I didn't see that translation from his concept to this piece. And then I started becoming unhappy with just the aesthetic. I wasn't too upset with his body pose. It was really just that left hand in his face. That's what was bothering me. Lily on the right, that just... Okay, her pose, that jacket, I lost her figure. The pose just didn't have, or not the pose, but the expression didn't have conviction. That's like that 1,000-yard stare. There's a smirk, but it doesn't show me something unique about her character. I wanted to see more than that. I wanted to see more of a spark in her face. And it wasn't showing that embarrassment. It showed more, I don't know, contempt, and I didn't want to show that through her. So this, her body, her pose, her face, this is what really bothered me, and I knew I had to completely rework her. So this next version, I laid down a little bit more background, and I completely redrew Lily's body, and I redrew her face as well, and I was getting a lot closer on her face. I also redrew Arlo's face, and I'm going, what the hell is that? The more I looked at his face, I mean, he looked so stupid. I started to loathe his face. I'm going, this is not working. That is not my character. I don't know who that is. But I stood back and went, well, got that wrong. And I definitely knew that he needed more work. But Lily started pleasing me a lot more. But I still wasn't completely satisfied with her face, and I knew I had to do something about it. But I'm getting a lot closer in this piece. Now, in this next version, it was almost coming together. I'd done a lot more detail work on the background, just kind of roughing in the areas where everything was going to be. And Arlo, I became very happy with. I finally got the face that I wanted. I got the arm moved out to the left, you know, the open palm, that whole just Broadway style on a knee. Like jazz, not jazz hands, but, you know, something very ridiculous. And then Lily, I still hadn't touched up yet, but in this one, Arlo was definitely the focal point. And I was about, I don't know, 90% there in this version. And then I finally got to the one that I think I really wanted. And I got that just that dumb eyes up to the sky smirk on Lily's face. And even that changed a tiny bit in the final. But this just about nailed it for me to continue on. And I splashed it with color. This is just fast color, just to kind of get my values and kind of feel what the piece is going to be, where the light, where the sun is going to be, because I wanted an evening kind of dusk, so part of the sky was getting dark. But this is kind of the rough, and this is where I knew, okay, I'm going to continue on to this, and we're going to start this thing for real. And this was just persevering. This was just continuing on and not giving up. So for the sake of time, I'm going to go ahead and cut out the line art and coloring the line art phases. I really hate line art. but I'm going to go ahead and start in on the coloring and the shading. And if you can't already tell, I kind of like some of the Scandinavian architecture in parts of Switzerland and Germany around the Alps. I think there's kind of a romantic quality to it. Not that these two characters are officially a couple, they're kind of longtime friends. I'm not trying to insinuate that, but there are some tones and vibes to that. What I also like doing is a lot of times when I do a piece, I will listen to certain types of music. It's like what Dick Clark said, music is the soundtrack to your life. And that's what I like to apply, where I look at a picture or I think of a picture. And I go, well, if there was any song playing on a radio or you heard a song playing during this scene, what would it be? What would the style be like? How would it feel? And one song in particular that I was originally going to put to a speed paint was a wonderful jazz singer. I think she's a jazz singer that I discovered not long ago. And Lord, I hope I'm pronouncing her last name right. It was Melody Gardot, G-A-R-D-O-T. I think it's Gardot, kind of like Stephen Colbert. I'm not really sure. But a song that I heard of hers was If the Stars Were Mine. And I just loved the tune. And I couldn't get it out of my head. And there was just such a wonderful quality to it with her voice and the composition and the orchestration. And being a musician myself, I had a great appreciation for it. And I could see that in this scene, almost like if it was a montage in a movie or something, like if you saw them just being with each other on this day and what it was like this would be playing as kind of the background music or the just something playing over the top of it. It's just something that keeps me going. Not everyone needs to do it like that, but it helps inspire me and have a little bit more push and conviction behind the end product that I'm trying to create. So that's what I'm going to go ahead and leave you with. On the way out of this video, I won't just end it with my voice. I will end it with the very end of the speed paint that I had hoped to build. So this is my salvage job. So circling back to the whole point of the video of embracing failure, it's going to happen and learn to embrace it. Know that even through the darkest times, there's going to be light at the end of the tunnel. As Churchill said, if you're going through hell, keep going. Because you will make it out, and you can't give up. You can't give up, and I'm glad I didn't give up, and I'm glad I was able to salvage and pick apart what I did, because I was able to get something that I became happy with, and actually a lot more happy than I thought I was going to be just by sticking to it. So never give up. This is Jared again, and I'll see you next time.
If the stars were mine, I'd give them all to you. I'd pluck them down right from the sky and leave it only blue. I would never let the sun forget to shine upon your face. So when others would have rain clouds, you'd have only sunny days. If the stars were mine, I'd tell you what I'd do. I'd put the stars right in a jar and give them all to you. If the birds were mine, I'd tell them when to sing. I'd make them sing a sonnet when your telephone would ring. I would put them there inside the square whenever you and I, so there'd always be sweet music whenever you'd walk about. If the birds were mine, I'd tell you what I'd do. I'd teach the birds such lovely words and make them sing for you. I'd teach the birds such lovely words and make them sing for you. If the world was mine, I'd paint it gold and green. I'd make the oceans orange for a brilliant color scheme. I would color all the mountains, make the sky forever blue. So the world would be a painting and I'd live inside with you. If the world was mine, I'd tell you what I'd do. I'd wrap the world in ribbons and then give it all to you. I'd teach the birds such lovely words and make them sing for you. I'd put those stars right in a jar and give them all to you.